So moving on from the new age data modeling of Sushant sir to Rahul sir, who will be probably telling us more about the quality that goes into modules. One interesting part that one of the speakers in the previous session mentioned is that a plant is either a Mercedes or a Maruti, and that is determined by the project construction and not by the O&M, whereas the O&M operator is supposed to be the driver who drives the Maruti and the Mercedes. It'll be interesting to understand that, what segregates the Maruti from the Mercedes, and how can O&M make a difference in that?
So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rahul Gadri, and I'm from DuPont India. Let me first thanks Mr. Jaggi for the nice introduction. DuPont definitely is actually a trusted company, and then it feels feels good to hear about that from other people as well, because it shows that for the last 216 years we are doing the right work and give it the right kind of products to the industry as well. In the previous session, we have heard a lot about OMM, different practices. A point was raised by Mr. Jaggi as well in terms of the Maruti and the Mercedes, and then who is driving, and then how O&M actually holds a lot of importance in terms of overall operation of PB system. So definitely, actually, a lot of things were discussed, but then one question that is still there is that whether we can ensure quality of O&M. So we have heard of two different aspects. One is that how we can improve O&M practices by introducing new technologies like drones, robotic cleaning and all. On the second hand, we have also heard about the kind of pressures that are there on the cost. So we have seen in the module that definitely when there were cost pressures, and which are still are there, the quality has degraded over a period of time. Whether that is going to be there in O&M, that is what has to be seen. And I hope that doesn't happen, because kind of issues now that we are seeing as far as modules is concerned in the field, we hope that that doesn't happen with regard to O&M, and people are ready to pay slightly extra amount to ensure that they have the right O&M practices, as well as when they are building plants, they have the right set of modules. Just to give an introduction in terms of what DuPont does. So DuPont, as I told you, is a 216-year-old company. And as far as PV is concerned, DuPont is this business for more than 40 years now. So I can take that crown from IBC of being the oldest company in this room. And in terms of the products, so we have basically supply materials for the manufacturing of cells and modules. We supply Solamet paste, which is used on the front side of cells. We supply Tedlar film, which is used on the back side of the module in terms of back sheets. And then we have some new products as well, which can be used for making structures, making bearings for trackers, and etc. And the numbers that you can see here kind of shows the experience that we have in PV. So we are in the industry for 40 years. So some of our materials as well, like Tedlar-based back sheets, are there in the field for more than 30 years. We talk about proven stuff. We talk about proven materials, proven modules. There is a live example where the modules with Tedlar-based back sheets are actually working in the field and working well. By that I mean that working, a power loss is less than 0.8% over more than 30 years. So one more point was discussed in the last session as well, that there are two aspects as far as PV project is concerned. One is the initial phase when you are actually selecting modules, selecting BOM, the kind of modules that are going to buy, doing all the testing on the modules to ensure that they are within the specifications. And the second part is the how is the next 25 years when once you have bought the modules, you have your plant installed. You want to ensure that the plant is working optimally, the performance is as expected, or maybe you can go beyond that. The issues, if the issues are there, they are addressed on time and effectively. So I would focus on the first part, that is the selection, module selection part. How a bill of material is a very critical aspect of the modules that you install in your projects. And then besides material supply, DuPont does a lot of field testing as well. So we have teams across the globe, in USA, in China, in Japan, in India as well. We go in the fields, we inspect modules mainly with the objective to understand how different materials are performing. Definitely gives us an understanding in terms of how our materials are performing, but overall we get a better idea in terms of how different materials are performing in different climatic conditions. So in India, you will see that though, yes, the PV has progressed very well in the last 5 years. In terms of long-term data, we don't have that much. But then we have data which we have collected, long-term data which we have collected from from other regions, and that is what I will show in my presentation. And what I've seen, that though we are not into O&M and all, but then what we do, the kind of studies that we do in the field, there is a pretty good correlation or the learnings for the O&M community as well. So I will just skip some of the slides as well. I won't cover everything in this presentation because of the time constraint. So I will just focus on some of these third-party studies which kind of indicate the kind of impact the focus on cost has had on the quality of the modules. So there, this slide actually has been taken from a report which was released by TUV. It's actually a global study and then included different components across the plant. And if you look at the data on your left-hand side, there are two pie charts and kind of engage the percentage defects in different components, be it modules, inverters, cables, and other components which are used in a typical PV plant. But then if you see the two data points, you will see there is a very high jump in the defect rate in terms of modules. From around 19% in 2012-2013, the module defect rate increased to around 48%, which kind of indicates that with time and with in terms of the modules which have been installed in the last 4 to 5 years, definitely there is a compromise in quality, and that is what has been now reflected in the field data as well. In the right-hand side, what TUV has done is that they have segregated different defects based on the impact on the performance. So as an O&M company, you will see a lot of defects in the modules in the field. But then what is the impact of that? What could be the future impact of those defects? Some of the defects might not be leading to any power loss or any issue at that point in time. But with time, they can definitely lead to a very serious power loss or a catastrophe as well in terms of current leakage or maybe electrocution of a person. So if you look at the modules, so what they have done is that they have segregated defects in terms of the impact that they have on the performance or safety. In terms of PSD, which indicates particular serious defects, then you have serious defects and less serious defects. And if you look at the particular serious defects, you will see a PID, which is something we all know that can lead to a very high power loss in less than 1 year time frame. Then you have issues like glass breakage, in which case as well, if you have glass breakage, then your module will not perform, will not give any output power, and you have to replace modules. And one more component which is there is the defective backsheet. So here actually the defective backsheet may not lead to any immediate power loss, but as soon as you have a defective backsheet in terms of cracking, it's an immediate safety issue. And again, we heard a lot about the numbers in terms of PRs, the kind of impact it can have on the revenues. But if you have a safety issue, and we have seen in the last maybe few months kind of issues that we have seen in restaurants in India and different factories, kind of impact it can have, kind of consequences it can lead to. So safety also is an equally important aspect, if not more than the number of units that the plant is generating in a year. So next slide is again indicating the same point in terms of the loss of or the impact of focus on quality or focus on cost at the compromised quality on the performance of modules. So again, this is an IIT study. So this study actually was done by IIT in 2014, but they have recently done a study in 2016, and the report has been published recently. In fact, last week only they have published this report, which is there on their website. So again, you can see in the performance. So the charts on the right hand side give the per year or the annual power degradation of the modules across different climates. So the left hand side chart is for the modules which are less than 5 years old, and the right hand side is for the modules which are more than 5 years old. And you'll be surprised to see that the average power loss in the young modules is much higher than the older modules. Again, indicates that the issues that are cropping up in the module which have been installed recently. And in terms of again the defects, so you will see the different defects, they have assigned risk priority numbers. And again, you will see the backsheet defects getting the highest RPN numbers. Again, in terms of, not in terms of power loss, but in terms of safety. So this is actually a study being done by DuPont. What we focus on mainly when we go to the plant is the visual inspection, because that is how the best way to find out defects at plant site. Definitely you can do a lot of analysis in the lab, or if you have portable lab, or if you have lab somewhere else, you can do a lot of analysis. But the first thing that you can do without disrupting the plant is to visually inspect the modules. And then you can actually get a lot of data in terms of how the modules are performing or different components within the module are performing. So what we have observed is that across an inspection of more than 1.9 million panels, we observed that in around 11% of the panels, we found defects in the cells in terms of snail trails and in terms of hotspots. So when you talk about snail trails, people say, yes, it's a defect. But then what CSS does is that it kind of makes cracks visible. Without doing any EL, you can find out whether you have cracks in the cell, in the modules. And then the second biggest contributor to defect is backsheet. So in around 7.5% of the inspected modules, we found found defects in the backsheet in terms of cracking, yellowing, delamination, and so on and so forth. And then 3% of the modules had EVA-related defects. So we found some correlation in terms of the environment as well, climate. So we have found that with regard to EVA and backsheet, which are polymeric materials, the defect rate increases in hot arid climates, which is something you will see in Indian climatic conditions. So in terms of, again, rooftop versus ground mount as well, we have seen higher defect rate in backsheet, especially in rooftop areas, mainly because of the poor air circulation at the back of the modules, and definitely in terms of the high UV reflection, because here actually, since the gap between the module and the surface is less, then that typically would be in a ground mount installation. So the impact of UV, which is reflected from the ground of a rooftop, is much higher than that in a ground mount installation. So this actually, when you talk about backsheets, and if you look about the different materials in the stack of the module, in terms of glass, all the modules would be having glass as the base material. If you talk about encapsulant, all the modules will be having EVA as the base material. But in terms of backsheet, you will see different materials are being used. And definitely, a lot of this is driven by, or change in materials driven by the cost. But then the cost definitely, again, as I had shown earlier, has an implication on the long-term performance of the modules, which is something you can see here. So if we segregate the data in terms of the defect rate across different backsheets, then you will see that in terms of PVDF, one thing is that the field data is for PVDF based backsheets not more than 5 years. So this is not a proven backsheet. Still has to be there in the field for around 20 years to claim that it's actually a backsheet which has been used in the field for around 25 years. But then this backsheet has not seen more than 5 years in the field. But within the 5 years as well, you will see a lot of variation in terms of defect rates. So some of the plants are showing 100% defect rates, means that all the modules are having defects in the backsheet. With regard to PET-based backsheets, again, you will see in terms of experience, yes, it's more than PVDF, but in terms of defect rate, it's again, there's a lot of variation. In terms of PVF, so PVF actually is something which DuPont manufactures. PVF is the chemical name, so Tedlar is the brand name. But with regard to PVF, one thing you will notice is that the experience is definitely much higher than the other backsheets. As I told you that this backsheet has been in the field for more than 30 years now, it's just a proven material. And in terms of Tedlar, we have seen some issues as well. But then again, when we talk about doing all this field analysis, we try to understand why those issues occurred. So those issues have already been rectified. It was mainly associated with using a specific design of backsheets, with Tedlar-based backsheets. But that has been rectified now. And in terms of the backsheets which are being used right now, those backsheets have already been seen in more than 25 years in the field. In terms of quantifying these numbers, you can say with respect to Tedlar, the average age is 5.4 years, but then in terms of defect rate is only 0.1% on terms of megawatt basis. Whereas in terms of PVDF and polyester based backsheets, the average age is less than Tedlar. In terms of defect rate as well, is much higher than Tedlar based backsheets. So these are some of the photographs now as well. You can see yellowing happening in terms of the inner layer side or outer layer side, and then you can see cracking as well. So the picture on the right hand side, you can see the outer layer is completely gone, in fact. And I would spend 1 minute on this slide, because with respect to O&M as well, this holds a very, very, very large importance. Because what we understand is that, and when one sees this kind of an defect in the field, as I told you initially, that it typically does not lead to immediate power loss. But then it's a safety issue. But as an OM guy, in terms of the defect in the materials or in terms of backsheets, we have seen this in multiple cases in India as well. In fact, one of the cases, maybe I'm not sure if I have a picture here, but then there are multiple cases of these issues happening in Indian conditions as well. But then as an O&M person, or the people who are working in the field, since they're not aware of this kind of an issue because they have never seen such issues in the field, they don't know the kind of implications that these issues can have. And then these issues will be leaking current, can leak current, and maybe the team would be operating there without knowing that the current leakage is there, which is actually a very serious. I'll just take 1 minute. Okay. So in terms of the issues or in terms of the consequences, so since these kind of issues can lead to current leakage, so effectively actually you're operating a plant which is actually leaking current and actually is a very actually leading to a very high risk of safety. So without knowing, if you don't know that this can actually lead to such kind of consequences, you are operating a plant and definitely you are actually exposed to a very serious safety risk, and it which can actually lead to an electrocution of a person as well. So what we do is that besides doing all these studies, when we get data from the field, we conduct trainings for the O&M teams, specifically on modules, but then we tell that what kind of defects you might get to see in the field. So this data we have got from other locations, but then this something can definitely happen in India, and something as I told you earlier, we have seen
the interruption, so if you could please move towards the conclusion.
Sure, yeah,
thank you.
So something we have seen in Indian conditions as well. So what we tell them, and if they see this kind of an issue, then what kind of steps they have to take, be it in terms of reporting to the model manufacturer, or in terms of taking precautions while kind of handling or testing these modules. So there are actually a lot more data in terms of what we have seen in the field, but I would just come to the conclusion. So in terms of, so one more side, actually just wanted to tell you that in terms of, again, ensuring that you have the right module for your plant, working on the first stage, which is around the development of the plant. So one of the things that you can definitely do is to specify BOM. And the BOM specification, again, has to depend on what is working in the field. Right now, you don't have the right test standards to test a new material. So if you are going to use a new material, you don't know whether it's going to work in the field because they are not right test measures. So the best way to find out which is the right material is to check by for how long they are working in the field, what is the for past performance. If something is working in the field for around 25 years, then that is the right material to be included in the modules, and that is what is being followed in China. So this is one of the case studies wherein for a single 850 megawatt plant, though four different suppliers was used, one BOM was specified, and all these manufacturers use one single BOM. So this is something you can also adopt, and then definitely I would again reinforce that both the aspects in terms of development of the plant, in terms of buying modules, inverters and all, and O&M are equally important. If you're looking for a performance, Mercedes performance, then you have to have buy a Mercedes, and then definitely you do have a right driver in terms of O&M who can ensure that he's maintaining the car pretty well, he's driving the car pretty well. If you're going to have a bad car or a bad quality car, right driver might not be help you much, and again there will be losses. And on the other side, if you have a good quality car, you have a Mercedes, but then if you don't have the right driver who is not maintaining car or who is driving rashly, again there will be losses. So both things are critical. Focus on both, and again I would suggest that spend a little penny on both the other aspects, because that is going to give the returns to all of you on the long run. So on this note, I would take your leave. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I mean, the last statement, spend a little more, that is like Janhit mein jari. Please do so as much as possible. Let's move on to Karthik from Sensoc. So Karthik from Sensoc is going to talk to us about usage of drones and different aspects of solar. What I would also request as a clarity, in order to avoid this question coming in from the audience, a drone usage in India is as much a technology problem as it is a legal problem. So you could also shed a little bit light on the regulation aspect of it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Karthik. I am the head of finance and operations at Sensoc. So just to start off, Sensoc is a UAV data analytics company. We help infrastructure companies gather data from the field, and we provide deep analysis as to how their assets are performing, how the design has happened, and how the construction is progressing. We are present across sectors, but our first love, so to speak, is solar, because two of our co-founders are from the solar industry. They're ex-Sanderson SVPs. Viral in the audience is also from Sanderson. I'm from Sanderson. So we have a lot of experience in the solar space. And true to form, we have really performed well in the in serving this utility solar industry with almost 5 gigawatts of assets which have been served till date. So before I proceed further, I'd just like to, with a quick show of hands from the audience, how many of you are seriously contemplating usage of drones on your assets? Quite a few. And I think some of the people in the audience have already used our products. So I think for people who are not familiar with how UAVs can help you, UAVs, they can deliver a bird's eye view of your plant at all stages of development. For example, when you're at the time of design, you want to see how your how the land is going to, the lay of the land. You don't want to encounter any geological surprises, so you deploy a UAV on the field and you get a clear 3D topographical map of the land that you're planning to develop. And at the time of construction, you would like to have a good idea of the construction progress. You'll be dealing with 10 subcontractors and 10 other suppliers, and you're not sure how the construction is progressing. In that case, you can use a UAV to get a true picture of what's happening on the ground. And of course, for O&M, which is the most, I'm sure most of you are from the O&M field, you want to know how your plant is performing, and you want to make sure that there are no non-performing modules, there are no module defects. So you do a thermal survey on your plant, and you can get a good idea of how your plant is performing. So what SenseHawk delivers, so UAVs themselves are not of much use for a solar practitioner, because in the end, when you fly a UAV over your asset, all you're going to get is a bunch of photos. These photos are not going to make much sense to you unless they're stitched together and presented in a good manner. So what we deliver as SenseHawk is a complete platform, end-to-end platform, that will make UAVs usable by the end user. So there are three legs to our platform. The first is, of course, the UAV itself. We don't manufacture UAVs. We use, so just to be clear, UAV and drones are going to be interchangeably used throughout the day, I guess. UAV stands for unmanned aerial vehicles. I should have made that clear in the beginning. But anyway, so we use off-the-shelf hardware, and we also use highly customized hardware, which can help you gather data from the field. We have developed a layer of software on top of the hardware, which makes it very easy for you to operate the drone, to manage your assets and so on. It's called the Link software. And once the data is collected, obviously you need to process it somewhere. And for that, we have something known as Hawk AI or Hawkeye, which is our data processing engine. And it uses, amongst other things, it uses machine learning and AI techniques to process your data and to detect patterns and so on, which will help you take decisions on the field. And the third leg of our platform, it's called Workspace. Workspace is a cloud-based window to all the data that's been collected, all the reports that have been generated and has been archived. So Workspace is a visualization platform for all your reports. And I'm sure many of you have been approached by other UAV solution providers, but what makes us different compared to the rest of the field is that we have a deep sector focus. Like I mentioned, four of us at SenseHawk have had a lot of experience in the solar sector, and from the beginning, our focus has been on developing solutions rather than just using UAVs for the sake of using UAVs. What we do is we first figure out if the customer has a problem, and then try to address that problem with a specific solution, and then work backwards, and then figure out how UAVs can solve that problem. Another important differentiator is the use of AI and machine learning tools. Again, AI and machine learning, it's a buzzword. It's being bandied around a lot these days. And we make sure that when we're using an artificial intelligence tool, it's being used for a specific purpose, as will be related in the rest of the presentation. And we also take security very seriously. We realize that we are working with important data for some of the biggest enterprises in India and abroad. So we have security at all stages of our workflow. We are going to focus on solar O&M, obviously. A specific case study. So one of the most important applications of UAVs in O&M would be thermographic studies. And thermal studies of thermal study of operating plants has been it has been tested for quite some time using handheld cameras, and it's proven to be effective, but not a viable option, because a person using a handheld thermal camera can only take readings from so many modules in a day. And in the end, it's a manual process. It's going to be expensive, especially if you need skilled labor to do this. And it's going to be slow. And in the end, you depend on the human being who's holding the camera to interpret the data and then mark the hotspot or the anomaly on the module. And in practice, what happens typically when you're using a handheld thermal camera is that you go around taking samples. Out of 5,000 modules, maybe you do 500 modules, and you use a you get a probabilistic figure of the defect percentage. So out of 500 modules, you're detected 50 hotspots, and you can extrapolate that and figure out how much you're going to how the overall plant is performing. But with that data, you're not actually going to be able to do anything, because the remaining 4,500 modules which you haven't inspected, you don't know which ones amongst those are going to be actually defective, and you can't go and take any corrective action when you do a sampling sort of method. So UAVs can really help you solve this problem, because UAVs are fast, they're inexpensive. You just need a single UAV, as it was mentioned. We can do around with a single UAV can do 25 to 30 megawatts a day if you really stretch our resources. And you can deploy two UAVs, and you can easily finish off. You can at least collect data from a 100 megawatt plant, and by the end of the week you'll have your report ready. And the other important thing is obviously the UAV is going to cover the entire site, and you're going to get all the hotspots, absolutely all the hotspots that are in your site can be detected and can be rectified at some point. So this is just an overview of our workflow. Like I mentioned, we have Workspace. Workspace is our cloud-based platform for operating a UAV. And using Workspace, you can scope out your plant, figure out what the optimal flight plans are going to be, and demarcate your plant into processing areas. And then, depending on the location of your plant and the position of the sun, we would recommend this not happen when the sun is directly overhead, because it affects with the. That's just one of the guidelines. So, based on a bunch of these guidelines, we determine what would be an optimal schedule for conducting the survey. And once the scheduling is done, we generate the flight plans, optimal flight plans, depending on what the battery life is going to be, how much area can be covered in a single flight, and the time of the day. And these flight plans are then executed, data is collected, and then is processed on our using Hawkeye.
Sorry for the interruption again. You could please move towards the conclusion. We are working on limited time.
Okay, just like FOMO slide. So yeah, so this is basically the reconstructed thermal image of a plant. So this is actually 500 to 1,000 images which have been stitched together to give this view. And if you zoom in, you're going to see hotspots. So the advantages I've already enumerated some of these. And so people are familiar with. I mean, some of you have already used our solution. So one major challenge that we have seen is that the actual plant layout versus what is on the AutoCAD drawing that we given at the beginning of the survey. There are lots of differences, and because of that, our planning goes out of whack. So what we need to do, what we have started doing now is doing an as-built survey of the plant. And with the as-built survey, we are going to actually give a, this is going to be done for free, and this is something that the O&M operator is going to be thankful for, because he'll know how his AutoCAD drawing is differing from what is on field. And using this as-built survey, we are going to number all the modules, give them unique IDs, and use them to so that these unique IDs can be used to track issues over the 25-year life of the plant. And the other improvement that we are going to do is we're going to start using special sensors, which are going to give accurate temperatures of each part of the module, so that you can get delta analysis of hotspots, and you can also rank your hotspots based on the difference in temperature versus the surroundings. And this is just a sample sample report that we generate typically for a user. So the image on top is the thermal image, and you can see the delta temperatures versus the surroundings here, and the relative position of the table within the block. So the O&M operator can easily narrow down and go to the particular table, go to the module, and take corrective action as and when he detects it. So we also classify the hotspots based on this is where Hawk AI actually comes into play. We classify the hotspots based on the pattern and the type, the probable cause, and the different causes include diode failure, bypass diode failure, a regular hotspot which could be caused due to a cell crack or bird droppings or even vegetation, and reverse polarity, and also a complete string which has gone missing. So this is an example of where an entire string has gone missing and is not producing. And we are planning to bring in further improvements where the hotspots are going to be further classified based on the probable cause of the hotspot, including cell crack or due to encroachment of vegetation, or due to any other regular cell defect. And so we are going to further, we are going to make our classification methodology more sophisticated with more types of, more classification being brought into the picture. And yeah, this is just a snapshot of our experience so far. And yeah. Thanks.
Great. Thank you so much, Karthik. Thank you for the new high-tech version of O&M.